Hocam ben o zaman oturumu açsam iyi olacak. Now I'm switching to English. Good morning everyone here and online. Thank you for being here. I am Nil Yüce. I'm going to be the moderator today. We are going to have five papers. The first paper is going to be from Asaf Varol hocam, from he's also our keynote for this symposium. He made his speech yesterday. And then we are going to continue with Asaf Varol hoca is representing İstanbul Maltepe University with the use of artificial intelligence in advertising and marketing. And then we have another online presentation, which is from Gabriele PROSPERI. If I'm pronouncing your name wrong, sorry
It
for that
is.
in advance. From University of Salento, there is also going to be the online presentation of his paper, Artificial Intelligence and Immersive Storytelling for Cultural Heritage, Personalization and User Experience in the RASTA project. Then the third paper belongs to me, and I'm going to talk about film viewing practices and experience of the new media audience. And then Dilan ÇİFTÇİ from Cyprus International University and Filiz SOYER from European University of Lefke are going to present their papers in Artificial Intelligence and the Digital Transformation of Collective Memory, a case study of Turkish National Commemorations in the Digital Age. And then we are going to have a pre-recorded video presentation from Can Diker from Mimar Sinan Fine Arts University. And hopefully we have another presentation, but we are having some technical issues. We are not sure if they are going to present in this session today. From Nevra Üçler, İstanbul Gelişim University, and Zeynep Burcu Şahin from İstanbul Gelişim University as well. Reproduction of gender inequality in artificial intelligence applications, hidden biases in coding and data sets. So, because Asaf Hoca has a very limited time, sorry hocam if we extended a little too much. I am just asking for all participants, both physical and online, to keep their presentations to 15 minutes. We are going to do our Q&A session at the end of all the presentations. Please use the time, be time wisely, and I'm now leaving the floor to Asaf Varol hocam, and with this paper, the use of artificial intelligence in advertising and marketing, and I'm leaving the floor to you, Asaf hocam.
So thank you very much, Ms. Chair and the dear participants. Today I am going to speak about the use of artificial intelligence in advertising and marketing. I try to keep the time, and please, if I extend the time, please warn me.
Okay, hocam.
Let me share my screen now. This is the agenda. First of all, a brief introduction will be done by me, and then theoretical framework will be discussed. Which kind of methodology we use for this work will be presented, and finally, the results and discussion will be provided. Transformative force of artificial intelligence in advertising and marketing is important, and when you are trying to use artificial intelligence in the field of the advertising or marketing, the artificial intelligence can be used effectively to get a result. For example, analyze consumer data, optimize campaigns, and enhance personalization. This type of the features can be done easily thanks to power of the programming. In this study, I would like to explain about the current applications and what is the benefits, and some challenges will be provided. Okay, in this figure, you see the customer interaction and value are presented based on the time. There are four phases, and these are called to reach, act, convert, and engage. You see there are different types of the colors in terms of circles, and the machine learnings are referred using the blue color, while the propensity model green color, and artificial intelligence applications in purple color. What is the meaning of it? It means when we are considering the time, how these phases can be act. And here in the reach phase, as you see, we are using the artificial intelligence features to create our content. On the other hand, smart content creation and programmatic media bidding should be provided in order to be used in the tools of artificial intelligence and voice search. When we are considering the artificial intelligence, then we have to think about the machine learning. Machine learning is a subtitle of the artificial intelligence, and it can be used using some different types of algorithms. It means there are some methods, for example, naive bias and the CNN, KNN, etc., regression, simulation, etc., can be used in terms of artificial intelligence. When we are considering the act phase, as you see, propensity modeling should be considered, and then we are producing propensity model for ad targeting, lead scoring, and predictive analytics. In convert phase, we can use chatbots. When I gave my speech yesterday in terms of keynote, at that time I explained how a chatbot can be used and which kind of the benefits of chatbots are available. And in convert phase, you can use web applications, and personalization can be applied in this phase. And the last one is the engage phase, and here predictive customer service and then marketing automation and dynamic content emails. I gave examples about the dynamic content when we evaluated the papers for evaluation for this conference. And for dynamic contents, it is possible to us produce the content very easily. Artificial intelligence is not only streamlining various tasks, but also improving decision-making by offering businesses deeper insight into consumer behavior. When we are focusing on the consumer behavior, then we have to consider, for example, how the consumer are deciding about buying some or purchasing some goods, and which kind of the tools they are using, and they get rid of the things like products and services to meet their needs and desires. It means the data is needed. The data are available for us, but how can we create some artificial intelligence tools to find the behavior of the consumers or customers? Artificial intelligence role in predictive analytics, which allows businesses to forecast consumer behavior and preferences, thereby enhancing customer satisfaction and boosting retention rates. In this figure, you see the consumer loyal to their favorite product brands are presented, and productivity, the quality of the products and value of money, product consistency and customer services is the shopping and selecting product assortment and pricing are important. And according to the survey, 74% was deserved for product quality. There are some methods that can be used for programmatic advertising systems, for example, A/B testing, correlation analysis, and machine learning models. A/B testing, there is another name for this test, which is called split testing or bucket testing. This is a method for comparing two or more versions of the website, application, email, or other content to see which performs better. You see, in this figure, there are two. We can say these are the web pages, but the layouts are different, and although the content is the same, the presentation is differently, and we have some measures. We can measure these two preferences using some methods, and after fixing which layout is the best, we have to use this for advertising our goods. The visual figure on the right side is showing the A/B testing and correlation analysis and machine learning models that can be used for enhancing the quality of the programmatic advertising. The increase of the use of artificial intelligence in advertising is particularly evident in programmatic advertising, where algorithms purchase ad space in real time, targeting the right audience at the right moment. As you see here, real time is important because real time means if a customer is looking for a good on internet or in some browsers, and this information is fetched automatically by the algorithms, and it is created some products. I mean the advertising for the for this type of the customers. How programmatic advertising works? This figure shows that, as you see here, data management platform should be applied using the demand side platform and supply side platform. And then every time the data are taken from the virtual environment, and it is evaluated, and a special ad is created using this type of the method.
Asaf hocam, sorry for interrupting. You have 5 minutes left, okay?
Okay. Okay, in this graph, it is show the conversion rates from 10% to 17% thanks to artificial intelligence. And then the personalization and targeting advertising should be considered. There are two subtitles for it: content-based, demographic, and predictive and behavioral subjects should be considered. Which kind of the survey did we use for this research? For evaluation, we prepared a survey, and we used the 5-point Likert scale in order to get the result of the industry professionals. And these are the questions that we applied, and then we got this result. As you see, we gathered about 100 response, and the sample size was 100. And we asked questions to professionals, marketing professionals, and the response distribution was 75% agree or strongly agree. It means the artificial, when we are using the artificial intelligence for enhancing the purchase of the people, then thanks to artificial intelligence, it is available. This is the statistical result. In this result, as you see, artificial intelligence significantly improves the personalization of marketing campaigns. This item was taken 4.2 on 5-point scale. And I am skipping because I have to close on time. And the correlation analysis revealed a moderate positive correlation, and we got the result of 0.65. Comparison with existing literature, we can say our result shows a good balance with the previous done literature surveys, etc. And it is shown here with the matching of the cafes. And what is the positive impacts of the artificial intelligence using in advertising? Increased efficiency, enhanced personalization, and better decision making. What is the negative impacts? Data privacy and ethical concerns should be considered because everything on virtual environment and this type of the data can be stolen very easily. Therefore, the people who are providing this type of the content should be taking care about this type of the privacy. And algorithmic bias is another negative impact. And the third one is job displacement. It means thanks to this automation, maybe it will not be possible for the people to be hired. And the loss of human touch, this is another disadvantages. Okay, in conclusion, I can tell the following: the integration of artificial intelligence in advertising and marketing presents a double-edged sword. On the one hand, artificial intelligence technologies provide marketers with unparalleled tools for personalization, efficiency, and decision making, resulting in more targeted and effective campaigns. However, the rapid adoption of artificial intelligence also brings significant challenges, particularly in terms of data privacy, ethical considerations, and potential biases. And lastly, I am telling the following: to fully leverage the benefit of artificial intelligence while mitigating its risk, companies must adopt a balanced approach. So thank you so much for listening to me. I think I kept the time. Okay, this is my presentation. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Asaf Hocam. It was very instructive for us. Now, not to spend much more time to extend, I am going to leave the floor to Gabriele PROSPERI for artificial intelligence and immersive storytelling for cultural heritage, personalization, and user experience in the RASTA project. The floor is yours.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you for inviting me. I'd like to extend my thanks to the organizers of this event and Professor Asaf Varol for inviting me to speak today. The project I'm presenting today is called RASTA, Artificial RASTA, Augmented Reality and Automated Storytelling for the Promotion of Cultural Heritage and Tourist Itineraries. This initiative to let you understand what is it about. This initiative is a part of a broader program funded by the Italian Ministry of University and Research under the PON 12 area framework. To give you some context, this program focuses on industrial research and experimental development across 12 smart specialization areas, emphasizing innovation and cutting-edge applications. The primary goals of RASTA is to revolutionize how cultural heritage and tourism are experienced in Italy. The project leverages technologies such as extended reality, intelligent narrative personalization, and advanced recommendation systems to create a dynamic framework. Instead of presenting cultural heritage as static and passive, the aim is to make it engaging, immersive, and interactive. At the University of Salento, which is in the south part of Italy, our research focuses specifically on Apulia, a region that has a rich medieval history. This provides the perfect backdrop for creating three immersive theater experiences based on iconic castles, Carlo V Castle, Corigliano d'Otranto Castle, and Ecaia Castles. Each site offers a unique opportunity to explore how storytelling and technology can work together to bring history to life. To make these immersive experiences possible, we started with a detailed requirements analysis. This involved identifying specific use cases and developing sequence diagrams for the systems that would power these experiences. By focusing on these technical foundations, we've been able to create a seamless blend of traditional theatrical storytelling and innovative digital tools. What makes this So here are some state-of-the-art about digital theater and digital storytelling. To understand the foundation of this approach, we can look at the evolution of digital theater. From its earliest days, theater has embraced technology to enhance performances. Think of the Deus Ex Machina, for example, in the ancient Greek or theater, or the introduction of gas and electric lightning in modern times. In the digital age, these boundaries are being pushed even further. Tools like augmented and virtual reality allow theater to merge physical and virtual spaces, creating new dimensions for interaction. The same for the digital storytelling. Similarly, it has undergone a significant transformation. Static linear narratives have evolved into interactive multilinear experiences. Janet Murray, in her seminal work Hamlet on the Holodeck, describes digital spaces as kaleidoscopic canvases where users can make meaningful choices and shape their own narrative paths. Brenda Lohler, similarly, in Computers as Theater, frames digital environments as theatrical stages that enhance emotional engagement. Drawing on Aristotelian tragedy, as Bandirali also notes, Laurel emphasizes elements such as plot, character, and spectacle to create meaningful and dramatic user experiences. The same for Mary Lou Ryan, that offers another perspective distinguishing between narratives as stories and narratives as experiences. So the project embodies these principles by integrating augmented reality and artificial intelligence to craft personalized and interactive experiences in theater. So let's look at what we have done until now. The technologies that we developed for the RASTA project play a foundational role in reshaping the interaction between visitors and cultural heritage. Gesture recognition, immersive projections, AI-driven narratives that create dynamic participatory experiences. At the core of the project is the use of advanced 3D mapping and photogrammetric techniques to digitally reconstruct historical environments with high precision, as you can see in this slide. Photogrammetry, a method that transforms multiple 2D images into a coherent 3D model, allows for the detailed recreation of architectural features, textures, and the overall geometry of historical sites. This process ensures that every reconstructed space is historically accurate and visually compelling. The use of neural radiance fields and 3D Gaussian splatting complements this approach, providing depth and realism in digital renderings by capturing complex lighting, shading, and spatial elements. We also developed, as you can see here, the immersive the gesture recognition systems. The immersive storytelling framework relies on real-time interactions facilitated by gesture recognition technologies. These systems use advanced sensors and AI algorithms to track and interpret the movements of the live actor that is on the stage inside these castles that we are using as stages for the theater pieces. The data collected allows for immediate changes to directorial elements such as lighting and sound based on the actor's actions. For example, specific gestures or movements can trigger alterations in the scene's atmosphere, dynamically adjusting the performance's structure. This capability transforms the traditional narrative experience into an interactive journey where the live actor's action directly influences the performance environment. Another technology that we have implemented is the immersive video mapping and projection technologies. The RASTA project uses immersive technologies to transform these historical sites into interactive storytelling spaces. So projection systems adapt digital content to architectural forms, while AR and VR create enhanced and fully immersive experiences. The integration of immersive video mapping and transforms historical sites into living interactive spaces. This technology uses projection systems that adapt content to irregular surfaces and complex architectural forms, such as the walls or of the medieval castles. Through precision mapping, video content architectural sim and seamlessly blends these into physical environments, creating the illusion of transformation and movement across static surfaces. Visitors then can witness historical reenactments, battle scenes, day-to-day activities from centuries past, projected onto castle walls, floors, and ceilings. The resulting experience is both visually and historical rich, and it captures the ambience and the atmosphere of the ancient times. Then the use of AI, as you can see in this scheme, and specifically the use of retrieval augmented generation RAG, which is a state-of-the-art AI model that enhances natural language generation through the integration of pre-selected data sources. This system draws on a curated repository of historical texts, primary sources, and period-appropriate theatrical scripts, ensuring that responses by a virtual character maintain both historical fidelity and cultural depth. The repository is built using meticulously selected historical documents, theatrical scripts, and cultural references to ensure authenticity and narrative depth. The integration of RAG allows for dynamic real-time dialogue generation, which adapts based on inputs such as gestures and interactions provided by the live actor on the stage. This dual structure, melding live and virtual actors, facilitates a compelling interplay of past and present. For example, the virtual representation of a countess, Countess Maria de Nguyen, who lived in Castle Carlo V, engages in dialogues shaped by the user interactions, drawing from a repository enriched with annotated and adapted historical texts. Here you can see an example of the interaction. The system generates contextually appropriate responses and employs a linguistic style reflective of theatrical conventions from the era being portrayed. This meticulous design enables a fluid and immersive storytelling experience, further bridging the gap between traditional theatrical narratives and adaptive AI-driven interactivity. By leveraging RAG's capability, the virtual actors' responses are crafted using predefined data sets, including carefully selected historical documents. This ensures that the dialogues are accurate and to the period, and resonates with the dramatic context of the performance that is bring to the stage, which is central for the experience, for the immersive experience. Another area of work is prompting. The prompts utilized in the project illustrate the system's adaptability to both traditional storytelling frameworks and innovative user-driven experiences. For instance, a historical immersive prompt, as you can see in this example, employs a 16th-century linguistic style to engage the audience with refined, period-accurate storytelling. In contrast, in the second example, a reformulated version adapts the narrative for modern museum applications, incorporating interactive and accessible elements while preserving historical authenticity. These examples highlight the dynamic interplay between user interaction and AI-generated context, showcasing the system's ability to tailor responses to specific historical contexts, so its fluidity.
Dear Gabriele, you have 5 minutes left, just
Yeah.
letting you.
Thank you. We can summarize the process of creating performative actions enriched with AR techniques as a flow of phases that begins with the selection of creation or creation of a script and culminates in the development of an interactive virtual environment. The process starts with the playwright's work, who plans performance content and assign specific roles to the actors involved. Subsequently, the script is drafted with particular attention to the narrative framework and the interactions to be staged. During the development of the virtual environment, the script may undergo changes to better fit the emerging technical and narrative needs. The playwright collaborates actively with the content creator to make any necessary adjustments, and then we have some rehearsals to transform, to adapt the system to the stage performance. Another area of work have been the creation of narrative model. The project's narrative model is rooted in the seamless integration of historical context and modern digital storytelling. Central to this approach is the use of a ghostly virtual character, typically representing a significant historical figure, and a live tour guide. This archetype, with its dual representation of past and present, offers a narrative framework that is immersive, flexible, and adaptable. The ghost, a virtual creation, capitalizes on the limitations of digital actors, such as their less defined facial expressions and the ethereal movements, turning these constraints into strengths that evoke mystery and narrative tension. Another important part of the work has been the collaboration with Factory Transadriatica, a theatrical company known for its innovative blend of traditional and contemporary theater forms that forms a cornerstone for the project. The partnership extends beyond acting. It encompasses co-creation of content, dramaturgy, and the integration of live performance with digital elements. These collaborative efforts ensure that technology serves the narrative, not the way around, maintaining a delicate balance between immersive digital experiences and the authenticity of human performances. I'm going to the conclusions. One of my area of work has been the contrast between history telling and storytelling. The project transitions from a static storytelling, effectual recounting devoid of narrative context, to storytelling, where immersive technology transforms historical content into dynamic, emotionally engaging narratives is very important. And I based my studies on Hayden White, that argued that historical events derive their cultural significance through narrative structuring. And this principle guides the project's integration of historical authenticity into interactive storytelling frameworks. One very important part of the project is the use of meta-narration that is central to this framework. The storytelling process itself as a subject of reflection. By exposing the boundaries between scripted and adaptive content, it encourages users to consider how history and technology interact. So the use of the ghost serves as a metaphor for the fluidity of storytelling, adapting dynamically to the user actions and revealing the interplay between memory and present exploration. Finally, the conclusions. The project, as you can see, transforms historical appealing sites into interactive storytelling platforms using AR, VR, AI, and RAG technology, bridging past and present, redefining cultural heritage as a participatory and adaptive experience. Future direction of the project involve refining immersive experiences, emphasizing narrative coherence, responsiveness, and historical authenticity. By blending tradition with innovation, RASTA reimagines how history can be explored, making it a living, evolving story that resonates with contemporary audiences while preserving its cultural root. I hope my presentation has been a good listening for you, and I thank you very much for listening.
Thank you very much, Gabriel, for this eye-opening presentation about immersive storytelling. Now I am going to present my own paper. It is titled as Film Viewing Practices and Experiences of the New Media Audience, a Literature Review. Now I need to also record my own timing. Thank you all for being here again. I'm going to talk about film viewing practices and the experiences of the new media audience. We're going to have a kind of a time traveling here as well, and I will do my best to express it in a nutshell. My research questions were the newness of the new media audience. What is new about them? Why we call this audience new? What is the newness of it? And which technological developments form the new media audience? And the concepts for defining the film viewing practices and experiences of the new media audience. And while I'm doing my literature research, there is also some common terms about television studies on digital television and polychannel broadcasting. The experiences that the audience have there is actually still prevails today us in film viewers in the new media environment. So there is some maybe some familiar terminology you will come up to about also television audience studies, but my focus is mainly on the film audiences. And of course, digitalization has a very important part to play here. Also the technological innovations and developments on filmmaking, exhibition space itself, and the distribution as well. And the nature of multi-layered audience. By that, I mean I'm talking about fluid identities of film viewing practices and audiences. So there is no certain, not to name certain typologies of audiences here. I need to get really quick on these because these are not limited with these topics, but the most general ones I picked up. When it comes to digitalization in filmmaking, exhibition, and space in enriching the film narrative, we're talking about CGI, VFX, 3D, IMAX, OmniLens, virtual reality, both in filmmaking and now also we have virtual movie theaters as well, and interactive cinema, where the audience actually decides themselves what is going to happen next. And the exhibition itself with digitalization also transformed during this era. The digital projection of films changed with the DCP digital cinema package. Exhibition itself becomes a smooth, transparent process. In here, we're digitally projecting the films. We're not even talking about the physical existence of the film reel itself, but it's almost now invisible, turned into a single file. And it's also raised some concern, as Bordwell also says. In case of space of the movie theaters, of course, there is also certain developments in there as well. I am going to also talk about the reason behind it. So in the digital era, it started leaving the dream palaces behind and then moving on to multiplexes. And today we don't have these multiplexes anymore, but we have a few cinema halls in the shopping malls usually. Luxury, classy, premium cinema. The reason why I use all these terms is because the catered meals served movie theaters with beds, the movie theaters where you can actually connect your phone and lets you use them. For higher ticket prices than the average, and it has different names in the terminology, so that's why I wrote all of them. And of course, we are beyond Dolby surround system, but as a milestone, I just also wanted to point that out. These are the other improvements, special improvements to attract the audience back to movie theaters. Back from what? back from film viewing experience in the comfort of home. Let me just skip to this part. Of course, the decades change in case of technology. The world is not simultaneously experiencing all these changes at once in the same decade. We are talking about the coming of VCR, basically. The video cassette recorders. I also took some icons here for the younger generations to remind them this is what it looked like in the olden times. This is very crucial to form the new media audience because we are talking about the time when the audience autonomy begins. So the audience does not have to depend on television reruns of films or any show or any type of program on television or a certain broadcast flow. Now they can capture and record it and watch them anytime they like in the comfort of their living room. So it also allowed personal collections to be made. And of course, I'm not going to talk about that in very thoroughly, but of course, these recordings of the programs also raised the questions of copyrights and piracy and the law infrastructure as well. We are talking in terms of technology, we are talking about domestication of these media technologies, which used to belong to the professional complex environment of media technologies. Silverstone and Hedden makes the metaphor of domestication, like these technologies are harder to reach, like wild animals in the nature, and we take them in our homes because now they are cheaper and more affordable prices. So we domesticate them, and they become a part of our homes, daily life, and leisure activities. And of course, one of the main also transformation comes in time shifting. We're not only not depending the broadcast flow anymore, but we are also shifting the time when we are not even home at that time. We can schedule the recorder to record a show or fi a film that we're going to miss when even we are not at home. This te VCR technology is that's why the it is like the milestone of the birth of new media audience here. Of course, through the 1990s and 2000s, we're talking about also digitalized broadcasting, polychannel broadcasting. The films are getting compressed to compact discs, and the film experience in our homes are even getting higher quality. We are having multiplication of personally owned media. We have personal computers, we have Walkman, we have Game Boy, and so on. We have also, in case of viewing experiences, the media audience is having now fragmented, so they can pause, rewind, fast forward anytime, any way they like. And they can repeat the pleasure of watching the film over and over again. And our homes are even becoming, I mean, after domesticating, even more surrounded with these personal technologies, also including sound systems here as well. So this was why what the movie theaters were also trying to compete with the comfort of their home because of these reasons. And of course, this leads us to the remediation, where the old media and the new media comes together. The Solopool and Jenkins coins it as convergence culture, where we have different fields of technologies in single screens. And it also allows us to have very individual ownership of films that's through a screen that could actually teleport us right into the movie anywhere we like. Space is also coming blurry in this sense. The audience itself becomes the audience itself becomes also resistant and migrant as well. So they don't have to depend on certain subscriptions anymore. When they don't like, they just migrate to another platform. This is also certain terms as well. And platform mobility is also a result of the convergence culture as well. You can, for example, switch your game console like your remote controller when you are watching a film. This was the simplest example I could now think of. And in case of film value chain, it's transformed it as well. The chain of production, exhibition, and distribution as well. I am not going to deeply talk about it, but it is worth to mention the COVID-19 pandemic, which is shrinking the theatrical window of films, which means that the time after they are exhibited, it takes shorter time for them to drop on the streaming platforms. I have 4 minutes left. We are also talking about, with the new media environment, the algorithmic audience. So it is also providing us customized viewing experience with over-the-top the digital platforms and as well. So measuring the audience becomes also another matter of discussion. And now, of course, platforms usually use interaction-based audience rating, which I can explain in just one GIF. And recommendation systems, like you may also like this. Audience autonomy also even rises more. And of course, the reason I use the quotation marks, also this raises the questions again, how they are processing our data of these digital platforms is unfortunately not that transparent at all. So these are the terms it is also used, like black box, wireshark systems. And of course, this customized audience experience also means because that's we always are roaming in, you may also like it is also turning us to get stuck in a filter bubble as well, where we have the single experience of the same genre, for example. This is also the time when we are trying to define the audience experiencing audiences, film viewing experience and practices as well. I borrowed this from Alice. Uses two concepts, time famine and choice fatigue, which is still relevant today. And I am sure if you think of its meaning and the correlation, you can also relate with that. The content, because that the content gets very abundant, the choices also becomes abundant. And deciding what to watch always takes time, and it's causing time famine because time cannot be banded yet. The indecision itself causes the choice fatigue, and the audience might even sometimes terminates all the experience of deciding to watch something and do nothing at all, but maybe watch a lot of teasers and trailers in a row. So this is the terminology that needed to be borrowed also from television studies. This is why I also use that reference as well. I have 2 minutes left and 5 slides. Okay. Of course, you're familiar with binge watching, which is mostly used for television series. But in case of films, it has a longer history. For watching movies in a row, it is called marathon viewing, and it even roots back to 1980s, where the Japanese VCR actually entered the US market with Japanese cinema, animes, and so on. And there were a lot of film clubs who are really interested in that genre, and they were watching films in a row, animes in a row, and this was called marathon viewing. So we can also today, we can also still talk about that today. And it is a part of the fan culture. Yes, I need to, I'm almost through the end. And because that we have these smart devices, the interactive process, the film viewing experience itself is not only now limited with one screen. Your attention could be scattered, and what you want to, because of the infinite instant flow of information, the audience needs a second screen where they can interact with what they are watching in one screen. Of course, this was also technically tried out as a single interactive screen, but it didn't work actually. There are a lot of trial and errors in this sector, and the users always wanted another secondary device to interact and use other services. And connected viewing also becomes an opportunistic sense in case of advertising and so on. But in my case of audience's film viewing experience, the attention is now getting scattered as well. And speed watching, it is, of course, I don't have much time left for the philosophical background, but we know that speed is the determinant of modernity. And if you're owning space, if you want to dominate space, you need to own the speed. And the immediacy is the only valid time zone, as Virilio says. And of course, with all this platform mobility and with all our changing dynamic film viewing practices, we should also coin liquidity in this sense as well. By speed watching, I'm talking about increasing the playback speed of what we're watching. And of course, this used to be possible with the programs, third-party programs, and using the console, but now it's also in the social media platforms and digital platforms as well, which is not very reactive, which was not really, let's say, ended up well in the filmmakers' sense, because their creative process is also getting damaged here. But in case of audience experience, because that we are surrounded with hyperlapse videos, short video sharing platforms, and compact contents as well, it means that we are also getting used to the compressed time video content as well. So this could also not yet as a permanent habit, but it is also, there is a tendency to do that as well. Speed and compactness is also defined by Neta Alexander as the cult of the digital age. So here we are talking about a joy, the leisure activity that we feel joy. Now it's all with the control of the audience their own. It turns into something else and fades. So it's not joy that we're talking about anymore. We're talking about fear of missing out. So sorry for stealing the time to just 1 minute more. The audience have, in conclusion, the audience have multi-layered characteristics, so there is no certain audience typology when it comes to film viewing practices and film viewing experiences. And it is it we should always think of digitalization as a whole when it comes to the newness of new media audiences, starting with the VCR. That's why I also wanted to point that as well. And there is not a certain typology that fits all of the new media audience in terms of film viewing. And for future, I could also say that the social media's impact on speed watching should also be focused on as a separate topic itself. I would like to thank you, and if you have any questions, you can also reach me from here. Thank you. Okay. Now we are going to have is Nevra Hocam here? Yes, we are going to have another online presentation. From Nevra Üçler and Zeynep Burcu Şahin, both from Istanbul Gelişim University. Görmediniz. Sorry. I have a news update, so unfortunately they are not going to be able to present this paper. Now we have a pre-recorded video of Can Diker from Mimar Sinan Fine Arts University, titled as an evaluation on the possible effects of the. Sorry. Ah, okay. My bad. Sorry. Ay yani. We also have another in-person presentation here. Sorry for skipping you. Oh my. It's my first moderation, so excuse me. And Dilan ÇİFTÇİ from Cyprus International University and Filiz SOYER from European University of Lefke are going to present their paper titled as Artificial Intelligence and the Digital Transformation of Collective Memory, a case study of Turkish National Commemoration in the Digital Age. Floor is yours. Thank you. Sorry for the inconvenience.
Sanırım buyurun. Kullanabiliriz. Kullanmayacaksınız sanırım. Kullanacaksanız mikrofonu önünüzde bırakın. Tamam.
Hello, thank you for being here today. Our study is on artificial intelligence and digital transformation of collective memory, and we are studying commemorations in digital platforms. This paper examines, I must say it will examine because this is the first step of our study, is the intersection of artificial intelligence technologies and collective memory formation, especially focusing on how digital platforms and AI-driven content curations influence the commemorations. For our study, we went to the Minister of Internal Affairs to the protocol office and took all the North Cyprus commemorations and celebrations that state presents. And there were in total 12 commemorations in North Cyprus from the state. Our methodology for the study will be a digital ethnography, social network analysis, and AI content analysis, which is going to be a mixed method. I'm using future tense because we did only the 10th of November, Atatürk's commemoration day, because this is going to last almost a year. So this is the first step of our study. And the aim of this study is how algorithmic curations affect commemorative practices across various digital platforms. And when we were thinking of doing this analysis, three research questions came to our mind. Do AI systems significantly influence the visibility and interception of historical narratives? Does algorithmic memory forms and chain and potentially fragment traditional commemorative practices? And do filter bubbles affect how different generations and social groups engage with national memory? When we are studying collective memory or memory studies, it is important to understand the theoretical framework as well. And our theoretical framework will be in four main titles. I'm going to talk about just a little bit of them. First of all, the interception of AI technologies and collective memory. That's the role of AI in shaping the collective memory. We can say that data analysis is very important because thanks to the digital platforms and AI algorithms, now we can preserve the documents and the resources and identifying patterns, and through generations we can transfer all these data recorded. Content creation is also very important. AI systems can synthesize historical data and cultural trends to generate narratives, articles, and even art that reflect collective memory. Archiving and preservation, I think, is the most important part, because thanks to the digital platforms and the AI technologies, now we can preserve all our memory documents and storytellings, because as you know, the communicative memory is limited over a lifetime of a human being. So it is important to record our memory. So AI technologies can help us to do this. The second title will be digital platforms as venues for collective memory. Thanks to these digital platforms, accessibility is a very important things. Community engagement, multimedia storytelling, and preservation of memory. We had another study in Lapta Alsancak Municipality, the urban memory study. So you can watch it on YouTube now. It was very important to register all those persons talking about their cultural and collective memory. Now it is all registered. And after the registrations, unfortunately, some of them died. So it was very important to do this kind of studies, which digital platforms now can make us a global connectivity and influence of algorithms. We can now continue doing other studies. The third title will be AI algorithms' role in historical narrative preservation and digital heritage preservation. As I mentioned before, the preserving the history and the memory is very important. So these algorithms can help us to preserve all our collective memory, cultural memory, communicative memory, all kinds of memories. So we can, with future generations, we can continue watching them and keeping them as in data. Last title for our theoretical framework will be national identity construction. National identity construction represents the process through which a collective identity is formed among individuals of a nation shaped by shared history, culture, language, values, and experiences. So in this study, we started doing our first analysis on 10th of November, the commemoration day of Atatürk. And we searched in our personal digital platforms what kind of posts we can see, what kind of artificial intelligence of digital commemorations held by other people, and we choose some of them. For example, first of all, our analyze will be Jean Baudrillard's hyperreality, which means that the human sense and interaction with space in normal life, how it changes by using the digital platforms and AI technologies. As you can see from this post, 355K times this post will reshared, reposted, and it says that in November, love is different. It's an immortal love that we remember. Even without image, even if you don't look at the image, Cyprus Turkish people of someone who lived here for so many years, without image, they understand what love means in November. But with this image, which posted several times, and now we can see the real world is reconstructed by these posts. So this physical space and social relations are shaped together in a natural process. This is the undertitle of Jean Baudrillard's Human Senses Intersection with Shape of Normal Life. With these posters, we always see the image of Atatürk, Anıtkabir, love, November. These are the commemorations that everyone remembers when they took their phone or took their
laptops in front of them and make a little search in social media, for example. When personally we attend to a commemoration, the limit, the person they are commemorating is limited. But on the platforms like this, thanks to the AI technologies and digital platforms, the commemorations can be spread to lots of people. The second title of Jean Baudrillard's theory is algorithm and hyperreality. Hyperreality is a state in which the distinction between reality and its representation is gradually erased. For example, when we look at this presentation, this post, if there is a republic, it's because of this face. This is the homophone word, it's because of this. Because of this face and because of this are homophone words, so that it means the same thing. So with AI technologies, we also use the semiotics, we also do our commemorations, not only seeing, but also listening and sensing the things in our hearts and keeping it for a long time. The third step of Baudrillard's theory is mediated communication. The importance of mediated communication is face-to-face communication is replaced with mediation information and all kinds of realities. For example, when we look at this image which was posted 523K times, we can see that there is a home where the pictures of Atatürk is on the table. There is a clock where it simulates the death time of Atatürk. And there are something says there, we will always make live the new ideas, and the symbol of infinity, which is most common use of Atatürk commemoration, the infinity symbol. And as well, they had an image that, as we can see from our window, the Anıtkabir. How many houses can see from their window of Anıtkabir? But with this image, the presenter of this image maybe wanted to say that Atatürk is at home. We always keep it close to us. So this image, imagine how many times passed through digital platforms and the commemoration became a reality. In person, maybe there are people who never went to Anıtkabir, who never attend to a commemoration of 10th of November baby, but thanks to the digital platforms and AI technologies, the commemorations come to our houses and make us commemorate with everyone at the same time, even if we are not together with them. So the key points of both the Earth's hyperreality will be our analyzing the other commemorations. The simulacras is very important. They are copies or representations of things that no longer have an original or referent. It becomes an idealistic and perfect version of reality, an artificial world more engaging and appealing than the real world outside. I would like to read it because from the posts we have chosen from social platforms, we can see that there is a representation of commemoration of him. All the time we can see the time of his death, but at the same time we can see an infinity symbol, which means that our commemoration continues, we continue remembering him, it will last forever. These are the messages that give us the posters. Media and sign. There are lots of signs in this commemoration post. Even the image of Atatürk is a sign, the infinity is a sign, the clock is a sign, Anıtkabir is another sign. So the signs, when we use a sign, when we use a symbol, the symbols make memory more clear. When we see symbols, we can keep in our minds
easily, and the memory will last more longer than reading things or listening things. Symbols are very important for us. Loss of the real. When we come to the loss of the real, in hyperworld, the origin of the real disappears and we are all left with a simulation. What is the simulation here? It may be that we never lost Atatürk. We never lost his ideas. He is always there. This is the maybe the message that the thoughts will give us, and implication of society. Of course, society means everything because it's where we live, this memory where it's shaped with shared culture practices, with history. Everything creates memory. We have not far from doing a conclusion, so I would like to show you our further analysis. From the list that we took from the protocol office, these are the upcoming commemorations in North Cyprus history, the 1st of December. As you can see, there are general commemorations, personal commemorations like Osman Örek, Dr. Fazıl Küçük, Rauf Denktaş, and also in the Turkish Cyprus, the North Cyprus states, we also commemorate 18th of March, Gallipoli's Martyrs Commemoration Day, which is very important in Turkish history. So we not only commemorate the Cyprus commemorations, we also commemorate the Turkey's most important commemorations because it makes a part of history. So I think a minute left, but everything is
30 seconds.
Thank you for listening us. If you would like to ask questions, our emails are here. We always studies about memory studies. Most of the studies are Cyprus memory studies. So yeah. Yes, thank you for listening
thank
us.
You.
Thank you for this very interesting topic of memory studies. Now we have a pre-recorded video of a of Can Diker from Mimar Sinan Fine Arts University. Due to an inconvenience, we are not going to have the in-person presentation as in the schedule here. So we will continue with the pre-recorded video of John Dicker's presentation. And after that, we are going to have our Q&A session.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to CIDA 2024 conference. Today, I'm going to talk about artificial intelligence, about its impact on film industry, and my title is called An Evaluation on the Possible Effects of the Use of Artificial Intelligence in the Film Industry. So, towards the end of the 20th century, computer graphics and digital technologies have taken filmmaking, as you well know, even further, thus offering viewers visual experiences that were previously unimaginable.